Welcome, welcome, welcome. You're listening to the Ask Brien Radio Show on KHS 1220 and 98.1 FM. Like no other station in the world! Is it? Why is it no, like no other station in the world, Emily?
Wow.
Because you're here, I guess.
Good answer.
Oh, that's a possibility, but it is like no other station in the world. That's their slogan. Why? You work here.
You I need thought to that know. Was your slogan.
No. That's the slogan ours? On the commercial.
It's to be fair, it is a sweeper that we play. It's oh. just one, it's one of the like
well,
10.
You learn something new every day, don't you?
It's one of the many.
Many?
It is. It is, it is.
I guess it is. So, Emily, you said you want to talk. What do you want to talk about?
I don't want
on the spot today.
You Ooh. Started off.
Started off?
Goodbye.
I did. I said we're like no other station in the world. We are. There's nobody else. Nothing. Not even Howard Stern. So,
fair enough.
We do have an exclusive today. First, Tracy is on assignment. That's from WKR.
Whoa.
That's from WKRP in Cincinnati. That's how Ness Lesman used to do it. I think John will remember that show with Lonnie Anderson. But we have our a new co-host just for today, although she might be coming back on more if she can survive. That's a big if, almost like the Survivor show. Mandy, are you there?
I am here. That's if you welcome me back, right?
Well, you know, we'll have to see. I have five pieces of wood, and you'll have to pick one, and whichever one's larger, that'll be the one. Now,
what?
You never picked sticks?
No.
Okay. Well,
again, like straws?
This younger generation. But we have our former engineer who's on the show today, and he's going to help us out and explain, because everybody says the name of the show is called Ask Brien, and you're Peter, and why are you calling yourself Ask Brien, and why you're spelling Brien with an E? Everybody is asked us every week, why do you spell it? Now, some people who have listened to this show, they go, okay, I've heard this one before, I know what it's all about. But many people have not listened to the show before, and they're always asking, why do you spell Brien with an E? Now, Patrick is Irish.
Yes,
so
I am.
There's a lot of people have been calling up and telling us, well, we think it's because Patrick's from Ireland, and there's a lot of O'Briens, and I'm always going to the O'Brien pub.
To be fair, my last name is not O'Brien at all.
I understand that.
Starts with
are,
an S.
But you are Irish.
I am Irish. That okay. This is also
so that's
true.
That's where the connection must be coming in.
Maybe so. But, I mean, Ask Brien was before I was even here, though, so
by
I don't
way,
know.
You're on KHTS Ask Brien, and you're wearing a Seattle Seahawks hat?
Yeah.
Well, why?
Well, you're a New York Jets fan, aren't you?
That's really hidden below the belt, although the way the Seahawks played last year, that's not a lot.
Fair.
They're pretty poor teams, both.
Oh, my goodness.
So is she clapping that the Seahawks are a bad team?
No, I think she's booing you for making fun of me.
That's pretty easy.
Yeah.
Don't make it so easy next time.
My goodness.
Well, give her some reasons.
Right. Well, the
other
E's,
than when Jerry comes in and screams, you know.
Well, the E's also happen to be like a theme of Ask Brien. There's a number of actual words that make up Ask Brien. Oh my goodness.
Emily's very bored.
I heard that, and I saw that, actually. It was funny. Number of E's. So one of them was something that you were not being very much of to me. It is called empathy.
And we already went over that, you know. You wear the size 14 shoe, I wear the size 8 shoe, so.
I was going to say 6, but close enough, yeah.
6? I'm not that small.
Oh, gosh. But yeah, no, so empathy is one of them. You were not being very
what
empathetic.
What does that mean?
We already went through this. It's the shoe thing. It's you can't fit in mine, I can't fit in yours type. You know.
But not everybody plays basketball, so they don't know about that.
That's you know what? Fair point. Right. Outside of that, we also have experience, because we are very people that are on the Ask Brien show are very experienced. And they're also experts. That leads us into our other one. Pretty
well,
synonymous.
We have an expert and a very experienced expert, as a matter of fact, today, when we speak to John very shortly.
Absolutely.
But those aren't the biggies.
No. There's still more. I know. Well, there's education.
Well, that is the biggest D, right?
That is the biggest
why
D.
Why is the biggest D education?
Well, because we want to educate you know, our listeners and just people. And education is a very, very powerful thing.
But what are we educating them on? Like 9 + 6 = 15?
Well, it's business, life, business life, just...
I think Emily's going to say something.
Go well, for it.
She stopped. I put her on the spot. Well, that's true. We try to educate people, and we try to educate them in a business setting so that they can learn something about business.
Right.
Some people, you know, don't know much about social media. Some people don't know about things that happened 30, 40 years ago that are still working today in business. So right. We try to go over that.
Yeah. And then there's a couple others, and these are kind of synonymous with each other, but we have excitement and...
That was very loud.
That was loud. Was.
Yeah. It's almost as loud as enthusiasm.
Yeah, I was getting ready to turn you down.
we're going to say enthusiasm, but because that was yours.
But what's Tracy's number one?
Grease lightning electrifying!
Woohoo!
Yeah.
And that has nothing to do with anything, but it's just
no. It's fun. It's just fun. It's a good E. Like I agree. It. I like it. That's my favorite one. Is electrifying.
Well. And that was from Grease White.
Well, yeah, of course. Great movie.
What other E's?
Let's see. Am I forgetting?
Emily.
Emily. Engineer.
Well, that is okay.
That is I.
So, we did experts.
Mm-hmm.
We did experience. Oh, did you explain what you need to do to become an expert?
Oh, no, but that's your prompt, not mine. So, what you do is...
You're the guy with the math.
It would be, I'm not the guy with the math, but I do what I can. You need 10,000 hours to become an expert in your field.
And how do you determine 10,000 hours?
You're giving me math again. I don't know. And you've told me this how many times.
All right, so if you work 40 hours a week.
Right.
That's what people consider to be standard work.
That's a standard work week, yeah.
Millennials consider it to be 15, but, you know. And us old people consider it to be 90 hours a week, but I guess that's the happy medium would be 40. You work 40 hours a week. You work 50 weeks a year because you get 2 weeks off for vacation.
Right.
So that's how many?
Not 2,000. Too much.
Oh. 2,000. And you work 5 years. That's 10,000. Then you're an expert.
Whoa. You know, to be fair, ladies and gentlemen, he just broke that down probably in like the most basic way that I could understand that. I actually understood that now.
And we know if Patrick can understand it, then our entire audience
can understand it.
Always use the lowest common denominator.
I'm educated, just math is not my subject.
Well, that's okay. For your birthday, I'm going to get you a calculator.
I already have one. It's called my phone.
Oh, my.
But you apparently don't use it well.
I don't have my phone out right now.
All right. Well, I guess without any further ado, and why do I like that word?
Because A-D-I-E-U is how you spell ado on every single letter, minus the D is a vowel.
And we're also known as the Sesame Street for business. and we have Big Bird. Give a round of applause to Patrick.
I'm Big Bird? No. I was thinking I'd be more like Snuffle Up, I guess.
Stop that.
I'm clapping for our Big Bird.
You're definitely the count. One,
you're the trash can.
Oscar.
The one who eats from the trash.
Oscar the Grouch. Wow.
Well, without any further ado, I appreciate your time here.
Of course.
We, you know, some listeners do want to find out about our guests. Each week it's a different guest. Today we have John Chaffin. Are you there?
I am here.
And you survived. Wow. Hey.
I'm here. Can you hear me loud and clear?
Yes, I can. Thank you very much, Patrick.
Of course.
We appreciate it. We'll be calling you in every 10 seconds just to keep you on your toes.
Absolutely.
He was our former engineer, and he doesn't come in on the show, so we had a great opportunity to have him. We have him on our show today. So, John, some of the listeners want to know, what have you learned? What is the most important thing you've learned about business since you began your career?
Well, when I first started in this business, an expert was defined as anybody more than 50 miles away from home. Not this 10,000 hour stuff, you know. But I think that in today's world, or what I've learned in my 60 plus years in doing what I do, and I'm still at it, is that there's so much opportunity for those people that want to succeed in life. I think that there, in today's world, there's so much opportunity because you always have a job that nobody else wants to do. And if you become the best at whatever job level and then go to the next level and become the best and go right up the ladder, and eventually when your hair turns silver, you become the expert. And I think that the attitude of wanting to succeed is really the key to success. In today's world, people think about, well, you know, how many benefits do I have? How many weeks of vacation do I have? And, oh, if I spend more than 8 hours a day, that's too much, and so forth. So all you have to do is more than the next person to succeed in your endeavors. I look at today's world as, in the business world, the Olympics every day, because there's somebody that does something similar to you around the world that wants to be better than you. And if you want to be the best at what you do, you've got to be like the athlete of the Olympic caliber today. It's a full-time job, day and night, 7 days a week. And sure, you can take some time off and so forth, but it's really a focus and dedication to the effort every day. And I think that my competitors, one of the best compliments I ever had was that, Chaffin, you're everywhere before I get there. And people don't want to jump in their car and go see the customer. During COVID, for example, people were sort of locked down, but I had my biggest year ever in all my career during COVID because I insisted in having eyes with the customer, sitting across the desk, walking in the plant, understanding the solutions, and trying to come up with the are you still there?
I'm totally here.
Okay. I was getting a ring on my phone. So that's, you know, I've learned that practice sort of makes perfect, and the more you practice and the more you learn every day that you apply yourself, you ultimately become the one to beat. And I think if people use that attitude and say, no, I can't do it, but if they keep trying, and they will, in fact, succeed. It's a pretty simple formula. And I think in my business now, I have friends, and my clientele are a lot of friends, because they know that they can phone me and I can address problems from A to Z in their plant. And in today's world, a lot of young people in sales, for example, they haven't even read the brochure yet. And they look pretty stupid when they come into a plant and trying to address the customer's problem. So I was in a plant recently up in Northern Cal, and a fellow phoned me. I had furnished a lot of equipment on his line, and he said, John, I need your help. I came in, and he said, some other guys came in here, but when they came in as a team of four people. And I said, and I bet their price on their equipment was to match so that they could support all those four people making a single sales call. And he laughed, and it was so true. But and the other thing that I think is what I've learned in business, the biggest problem in business is integrity of people. And I think if you have honesty on your side, you never have to look over your shoulder. People understand that you're an honest person and you do what you say you're going to do in a very responsive way. And I mean, in today's world, people can pick up their phone and dial anybody, but so many people, they'll get a call and they won't respond for a day or two or weeks even. But, you know, if I get a call and it's not done within the next few minutes, I'm behind. And I think that is something that people have got to learn if they want to succeed in life as well.
So during COVID, did you have any people that were saying, "Hey, I won't meet with you" when you tried to set up these meetings in person?
There were a couple, but invariably, I was able to get into the plant and go through the protocols of getting your temperature. And, you know, when they took my temperature, I always asked them if I was still hot stuff, and they said yes.
Well, that's what you're known as, hot stuff.
I had lunch with a fellow that was a competitor, and he said, "Oh, during COVID, he hasn't been doing anything, but he's been working on the deck at the house and all of this other stuff." And I just thought to myself, "You just keep working on your deck, and I'll be out here visiting your customers."
Well, that's a great thing. Mandy had a question. Go ahead.
Oh, I do? I guess I do. No, you know what? Actually, I was, because you've been doing this so long, I wanted to know, like, what was the very first design or engineering design that you ever did?
Geez, there's been so many things that I've been in. You know,
I mean,
most
just
of
because
my...
things have changed so much, you know, I was just interested in... And for how long you've been doing this from, you know, a long time ago to today?
A lot of the technology that's been there has just been enhanced. I remember back in 1967 when this fellow came in to our plant and he wanted to electronically color sort pistachios. And he said, "We're going to start planting orchards here in California, and we're going to take over the world's production." Now I think we probably account for about 85% of the world's pistachio production in the world. And in the process of hulling the pistachio, they would put them in water, and the hull would discolor the white shell of the nut. And that was not very desirable. Most of the product at that time that was being imported was dyed red. So it would cover up all of the blemishes. And so it was thought that if we could get a nice, shiny, white pistachio, that would be wonderful. And so we did have a machine that we converted from peeling carrots and potatoes and stuff like that to polishing these pistachios. And I know one plant here in California has about 125 of those machines just in that one plant. And that's why you have nice white pistachios, so you can crack them.
You learn something new every day.
Yeah. And we're going to be right back. You're listening to KHS 1220, 98.1 FM, The Ask Brien Show. Welcome back. You're listening to The Ask Brien Radio Show on KHS 1220 and 98.1 FM. We have a great guest today, John, and my co-host Mandy. So before we went to break, we were talking, and I have a follow-up question, John. Of all the products that you've seen that you thought were going to be successful, is there anyone that you thought was going to be successful that didn't become successful?
Yes, and it was a product that was trying to be developed by a company by the name of Memron. They were located in Silicon Valley. All these fellows had been involved in the company called Verbatim, and they were going to densify the magnetic materials on floppy disk so that the particles or the magnetic material on the floppy disk would stand vertical. And if they could do that, they could densify or improve the capacity of a floppy by 10 times. And I was selling packaging machinery that would take the floppy automatically and put it into a envelope that you would get when you bought it. But they were never able to successfully achieve that, and they were running short on funds, and they I said, well, how much money do you need? And they said, well, we're still looking for $1 million. And I phoned a few of my friends, and we put in $1 million, and we lost it all. So that's one of the unsuccessful stories.
But you have a lot of very successful stories, and Mandy was going to ask you something about the Macintosh. So, Mandy, you want to go?
Yeah, I have a question. So I'm interested in learning more about, you know, your packaging successes that you've had. Can you share some of those with us?
Sure. I think, I do packaging machinery and processing, so I'm able to walk into a plant and understand and address from the front end to the back end. I remember when Andy Berliner started Amy's Kitchens, which is now over a $1 billion company. You see their product, it's organic entrees and soups, and in the frozen food cabinet, as well as your canned goods cabinet for the soups. I remember when he was buying beans in cans, opening up the cans and putting them and cooking them, and all, it was really tedious. And I said, Andy, I said, you need a continuous cooker for your beans. And he said, oh, well, what's that? You know, and I told him and showed him the equipment, and he said, I can't afford that. I said, well, if you would like to get this machine, I said, I'll buy it for you, and you can pay me over the next 5 years. And so he did that, and now Amy's Kitchen was named after his daughter, Amy, and a huge success story there. I've done everything from Marie Callender pies to Apple Macintosh computer lines. And the Macintosh computer thing was fun because I had 11 competitors. My machine actually took the computer and loaded it into a case from the bottom up, and nobody else was doing that. And they had this case that looked like a Holstein cow. It had black and white covering on it. You know, I think just the case itself, even back then, cost about $4 a piece. But it was part of the Apple image that they wanted to present. And, the Macintosh ultimately got replaced by all the stuff that we've seen over the last couple of decades. But, if you can think about it, you can achieve it. You know, it's just like Elon Musk said in one of his speeches that the engineering is really the magic of today and tomorrow.
You know, when you mentioned the word the cow spots, whatever, I was thinking of Gateway Computer. Gateway Computer was started in the Midwest by someone that actually, I think he even started the company near a farm. So when you're talking about the packaging for the Macintosh originally with the cow spots, I was thinking Gateway. I didn't think you were going into the Apple part.
Yeah.
now you, as I recall, you mentioned to me earlier that there are 11 companies that were competing. Now, you had this product that went from the bottom, took it from the bottom up to put it into the package. What were the other companies doing? They took it on the sides?
They took it on the sides and or top-loaded it, and it made a very long machine. And it took up a lot of room. And, room in any plant has a lot of value. And we handled it more gently and more positively, and it was just the right choice. Not because I won, but it was because it was the right engineering approach for the application.
But what made you think about that? Because everybody else was, you've got 10 other people that are competing against you. They're all thinking on the sides and from the top. What made you, what bell rang in your head that said,
I knew this fellow that had a shop up in Sonoma, and he made this machine, and he was the first one that had the patents on a bottom-up load case packing machine, and he patented it because it could be used for margarine and butter containers that had a snap cap on it. And if you load a snap cap from the top, many times the cap would get caught on something and it would pop off. So that was not satisfactory. So if you loaded it from the bottom up, it wouldn't catch on anything because it was going up through and would stay on the container. And I thought, that's the machine for the Macintosh.
So from butter to computers.
Yes.
That is really interesting. Yeah. Mandy?
Nope. I'm just agreeing with you.
Well, I thought you had another question, but if not, I can ask one, but go ahead.
What's the most successful project you've done throughout all these years?
Oh,
besides the Yes, Brien show.
I see. You know, I did a lot of processing equipment for the folks that made Butterfinger and Baby Ruth candy bars. I did a lot of work for Tootsie Roll Industries. If it's packaged or processed, you know, I don't know if you remember when you were a kid, you got fruit leather from General Mills, right? I supplied all of the processing equipment for the fruit leather. Popcorn still out there, you know. If you buy powdered sugar, it's probably done on machines that I take granulated sugar and grind it into powdered sugar at 5,000 pounds an hour per machine. If you have a pouch of sugar or sweetener at your restaurant table, those pouches are now produced at 4,000 a minute. So it's come a long ways.
So are you a do-it-yourself guy? It sounds to me like you're out there selling the machines. Are you doing this with another group of people, or you do this on your own?
Yeah, I'm a company of one, but I have a few thousand people behind me. I used to have sales offices in St. Louis and Denver and L.A. and up in the Northwest and a bunch of people out of Monterey area where my offices are, but I just decided I'm tired fooling with all of this other stuff. And enjoy doing what I'm doing now, and I'm selling more than I ever have. So that's what's fun about it.
Let's go back to the early part where we're talking about, you know, that you're meeting people directly, even during COVID. So what's your thought pattern on remote living? I mean, a lot of people like the remote living because they say, hey, listen, I can live in Hawaii and work in South Dakota, and, you know, that'd be nice for me. So I kind of like that concept. But, you know, I'm kind of old school, and I grew up where when I worked for a company, you know, it's good to have everybody in that meeting room, not on a Zoom, but actually in the meeting room.
Oh, absolutely. I want all my competitors to be on Zoom and in their basement talking to customers that will never buy from them. Because it's as simple as that. I think, I had one customer, I put in a nut butter line. You know, they do almonds and walnut nut butters. And my proposal was 143 pages. Lyle made the, Mandy, you know, Lyle, he made the proposal up for me when he was living in Minnesota, and he just, I would give him all the material, he would do the layout and so forth, he'd send the documents to FedEx, I'd pick it up all bound, and take it into the customer, and they say, you know, here, I can do A to Z on this whole line. And I had one customer who said, John, we don't know what we're going to do when people like you aren't around any longer because, you know, you have the answers to everything that we're trying to address here. And, you know, as long as people want to stay in their home or basement or in Hawaii or whatever, you know, they're not going to get their share. I use the term, I'm still out here getting my unfair share.
and you're on a business trip right now, correct?
Yes, I am.
I don't need to tell the cities you went to, but you traveled over 500 miles in the last day just to go off to try to get an order, and you've been doing this for over 61 years, and you didn't start when you were born.
No, I I'll tell you one story. In my early career, I had all of Northern California, Oregon, Washington, Idaho, and British Columbia. And I had a project over in Western Oregon. And I rolled in there on a Friday afternoon, and I had a big meeting with six of their engineers and plant management and so forth, and I could not convince them to buy my machine. And they asked me to come back on Monday. So I stayed in Walla Walla over the weekend, came back, and I did the same thing that I did on Friday, and I still couldn't convince them. I spent 2.5 hours on the blackboard back then. I drove back home to the Central Coast, and on the following Friday, I phoned this guy, Harold Rice, who's the plant manager, and I said, "Harold, what's going on?" He said, "Oh, John, if I told you, it would ruin your weekend. And phone me Monday." Well, back then we had teletypes, and I had a secretary, and I asked my secretary, "Bonnie," I said, "I want you to telex Harold Rice the following. Dear Harold, I am going to have a fantastic weekend anyway, signed John Chaffin." And so about 10 minutes later, my secretary came in. She said, "Johnny, come in, look at the telex." There it was. "Dear John, happy weekend, purchase order number such and such." And so I phoned him and I said, "Harold, what's going on?" He said, "Well, we as a committee decided that you guys were so close that we decided that whoever gave up first lost, and you never gave up."
Well, that is the old adage, you know, if you don't give up, you can't fail.
Yeah, that's right.
And that's an old-timer one, too. So a couple of questions. Who's the most famous person you ever met?
Most famous person ever met, or infamous. I met the Japanese fellow who led the attack on Pearl Harbor, Michio Fujita, when I was 12.
Wow.
I had lunch with Norman Mineta, who used to be Secretary of Transportation. I had lunch with him in the Capitol building in Washington. My oldest brother went to San Jose High School with Norman. And then, who else? Bill Marriott. I met him at the Pebble Beach Car Show a few years ago.
The Marriott Hotel?
Yes. Uh-huh.
Small little group there.
Yeah.
We're going to be taking a break. We're going to be right back. You're listening to KHS 1220, 98.1 FM. Welcome back. You're listening to the Ask Brien Radio Show on KHS 1220 in 98.1 FM. So, John, we don't have that much time left, but I did have one more question. So if you graduated high school, okay, you're not sure if you want to go mm-hmm. to college or not, you want to go out in the workforce maybe, and this is the current time period, what would you tell a graduate? What would you tell them to do? And what business and industry do you think is the place to be?
There's three ways to the, if you want to succeed in life, there's in the business world, you can either do engineering, finance, or sales. But with all of that, I think that a technical background helps in all of those areas where you're involved in knowing how things are made. So mechanical engineering, electric engineering, all of that I think is really important because if you understand how things are made and you can think about how things can be better made, and that's what the evolution of industry is all about. So I would just say major in something that you can make a good living and contribute to society. I create a lot of jobs because of the machinery that we sell. And I think, you know, that's what I would recommend.
Well, it's very opportune because, you know, this is time period when people graduating high school, some people graduating college, and they have to decide mm-hmm. what they want to do with their life besides living at home with mom and dad, which a lot yeah. of people still like to do in their 30s nowadays. So that's a true fact. Emily's going like, "Huh? What are you talking about?" Yeah, it's true. A lot of these people like to live at home. It's nice and safe and easy. Mandy had some questions about how to reach you. So go ahead, Mandy.
Well, I had one question before that. You know, just adding on to what you had just mentioned, John, I want to know more about the latest technology. As you know, I work with a food company, and mm-hmm. we're always interested in ways to take advantage of the labor shortage. You know, what are your thoughts?
Well, if things can be done manually, they can do robotically. And I am just so busy automating the West Coast with robots. You can't believe it. I can do it fast or faster than the human can. And if people don't want to come to work, I'm sorry, folks. We're going to automate those jobs. And the people that know how to work on robots and engineer and make them and assemble them and be involved, that's going to be an opportunity for them. I've always used an expression, somebody's plight is somebody's delight. So if you elect to sit home and collect the government checks while other people are out there trying to succeed, it will be to their delight that you still sit home.
Right.
Great analogy.
So how does one reach you? How does one contact you?
Well, my website is WSM, like William Sam Mary, hyphen, and I have to say that's a dash in the middle because a lot of people don't know what a hyphen is anymore. hyphen corp.com. And, you know, a lot of our stuff is on there. If you click into services and capabilities, you'll see everything that we do in alphabetical order by subject. And that covers about 80% of what we can address. And if you don't see it there, you phone me and we'll come up with a solution.
What's the connection, WSM? I thought your name is John Chaffin. So
well, it's Western States Machinery Corporation.
Okay.
That's the name of my company. And so, you know, we do everything that you can see on your grocery shelf and then some before it got there.
What was the highest revenue year that you had in your career?
I think done about 26, 27 million.
And that was with a company? With a whole bunch of people working for you, or, you know, it wasn't solo, right?
No, that's one. I had a staff of people, you know, we had, and that goes back, well, you know, when I started in business for myself when I was 32 back in 1971, started in the rep business, and by 1980 had purchased three of the companies that we had represented. And so we went from zero to 25 million in sales in 9 years, and so in today's world, that was like $100 million company equivalent.
Well, especially with inflation, and it's probably even double that now, with $5 gas the norm. Yeah. Well, thank you very much. Appreciate your time. We're going to have you back on again. You've given us a lot of wisdom, and we like to have that. We're probably going to add a W to the E's because we need to have wisdom on here. Very, very glad to have you on the show.
But Mandy, just remember that the older you get, your wisdom surpasses your knowledge.
And if you could remember, if you had all your knowledge when, you know, 40 years ago, just think who you'd be today.
That's right.
Exactly. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I've been listening to the Ask Brien Radio Show. Thank you, Mandy. Thank you, John. We'll be on next week. KHCS 1220, 98.1 FM, over and out.